Welcome to lecture 14. The theme of the lecture is Lord Byron, British Romantic Poet. After the lecture, students will be able to become familiar with the key characteristics of Lord Byron and his poetry, describe the term Byronic hero, and explain the significance of Byron's poems. During the lecture, we are going to discuss the following questions. The first, George Gordon Byron, his early life. The second, his literary career. And the third one, contribution of Lord Byron to the English literature. Lord Byron, in full George Gordon Byron, the 6th Baron Byron, was born in January 22, 1788, London, England, and died in April 19, 1824 in Greece. British romantic poet and satirist whose poetry and personality captured the imagination of Europe. Byron was the son of the handsome and profligate Captain John Byron and his second wife, Catherine Gordon, a Scots heiress. After her husband had squandered most of her fortune, Mrs. Byron took her infant son to Aberdeen, Scotland, where they lived in lodgings, meager income. The captain died in France in 1791. George Gordon Byron had been born with a clubbed foot and early developed an extreme sensitivity to his lameness. In 1798, at the age of 10, he unexpectedly inherited the title and estates of his great uncle William, the 5th Baron Byron. His mother proudly took him to England, where the boy fell in love with the ghostly halls and spacious ruins of Newstead Abbey, which had been presented to the Byrons by Henry VIII. After living at Newstead for a while, Byron was sent to school in London, and in 1801 he went to Harrow, one of England's most prestigious schools. In 1803 he fell in love with his distant cousin Mary Chaworth, who was older and already engaged, and when she rejected him she became the symbol for Byron of idealized and unattainable love. He probably met Augusta Byron, his half-sister from his father's first marriage, that the same year. In 1805, Byron entered Trinity College, Cambridge, where he built up debts at an alarming rate and indulged in the conventional vice of undergraduates there. The signs of his incipient sexual ambivalence became more pronounced in what he later described as a violence through pure love and passion for young chorister John Eddleston. Alongside Byron's strong attachment to boys, often idealized as in the case of Eddleston, his attachment to women throughout his life is an indication of the strength of his heterosexual drive. In 1806, Byron had his early poems privately printed in a volume entitled Figurative Pieces, and that same year he formed at Trinity what was to be a close lifelong friendship with John Cam Hobhouse, who stirred his interest in liberal Whiggism. In 1803, Lord Byron fell in love with Mary Chaworth, but she rejected him as she was already engaged. He had a tumultuous love affair with Lady Caroline Lamb and wanted to elope with her, but was prevented from doing so by Hobhouse. His next lover was Lady Oxford, who was impressed by Byron's radicalism and even encouraged it. In 1813, he got romantically involved with his half-sister from his father's first marriage, Augusta Leigh, who he had met in Newstead in 1803. She was already married to Colonel George Leigh. To get away from this situation, he carried out a flirtation with Lady Frances Webster for some time. Frustrated and depressed, he married Anne Isabella Milbank in January 1815, but the marriage was unhappy. Anne Isabella was not the kind of woman Byron usually went after. Scholars speculate that marriage might have been a bid for respectability or a way to distance himself from the relationship with his half-sister that even he knew was wrong. Annabella, for her part, fell wildly in love with the hot young Baron who wrote love letters to die for. The couple married the 2nd January 1815. It was immediately clear to both of them that they had made a huge mistake. Almost immediately after the wedding, Byron took his wife to visit Augusta, whose husband was away. During the 2-week visit, Annabella slept alone in a guest room while Byron and Augusta shared the master bedroom. Byron and Annabella's marriage fell apart spectacularly hard and fast. He had a daughter with her named Augusta Ada, who was born in December 1815. After leaving England in 1816 and settling in Geneva, Switzerland, he renewed his love affair with Clary Claremont, which he had started while he was still in England. In 1817, Claremont moved to England to give birth to Byron's illegitimate daughter, Allegra, in January 1817. In October 1817, while in Venice, he carried on a love affair with his landlord's wife, Mariana Segatti. While in Rome, a baker's wife named Margherita Cogni became his new lover. In Ravenna in 1818, he met Countess Teresa Gambi Guiccioli, who was 18 years old and married to a man who was 3 times older than her. Though Byron had become fat and had long gray hair at that time, he convinced her to come back with him to Venice, which she did. Lord Byron published his early poems, Fugitive Pieces, in 1806 with the help of a privative publisher and also befriended John Kemp Hobhouse. His first collection of poems, Hours of Idleness, published in 1807, received bad reviews in the Edinburgh Review. He wrote a satire, English Bards and Scots Reviewers, in 1809 in answer to these and gained much popularity. After graduating from Cambridge University, Byron started on a tour through Portugal, Spain, Greece, Turkey, and Albania. He returned home in 1811. A trip to Europe resulted in the first 2 cantos of Thald Harald's Pilgrimage in 1812, a mock heroic epic of a young man's adventures in Europe, but also a sharp satire against London society. The poem contains elements, though to be autobiographical, as Byron generated some of the storyline from experience gained during his European journey. Byron achieved numerous fame and influence throughout Europe with works exploiting the violence and drama of their exotic and historical settings. However, despite the success of Thald Harald and other books, Byron was forced to leave England for good in 1816 and seek asylum on the continent. Here he joined Percy Bysshe and Mary Shelley on the shores of Lake Geneva. His unsuccessful love affairs made him gloomy and remorseful and resulted in the writing of the Dower and the Bride of Abydos in 1813 and the Corsair and Lara in 1814. Count of the First describes Portugal and Spain. Byron shows his surprise at the contrast between the splendor of the land, where fruits of fragrance blush on every tree, and the poverty of the people. In the Spanish scenes, the poet shows the people's struggle against Napoleon's invasion, which the poet witnessed during the stay in Spain in 1809-1810. Count of the Second is devoted to Albanian Greece. Byron admires the Albanians for their kindness, generosity, and hospitality. But when Harold comes to Greece, he is disappointed. His miserable state of the Greek people under the yoke of the Turks arouses Byron's indignation and makes him recall the glorious past of Greece. Count of the Third describes the beautiful scenery of Switzerland, pictures of nature, now calm and serene, now stormy, and the feelings of the poet himself, ultimate with philosophical reflections. Count of the Fourth's dealing with Italy depicts people and events of ancient history. Byron calls Italy the mother of art. Byron puts forth the idea that true glory is achieved through creative activity and not by birth and power. The archetype or character type of the Byronic hero was first developed by the famous 19th century English romantic poet Lord Byron. Most literary scholars and historians considered the first literary Byronic hero to be Byron's Failed Herald and the protagonist of Byron's epic poem, Failed Herald's Pilgrimage. However, many literary scholars and historians also point to Lord Byron himself as the first truly Byronic hero, for they exemplified throughout his life the characteristics of the sort of literary hero he would make famous in his writings. A Byronic hero can be conceptualized as an extreme variation of the romantic hero archetype. Traditional romantic heroes tend to be defined by their rejection or questioning of standards, social conventions, and norms of behavior. Byronic heroes tend to be characterized as being intelligent, cunning, ruthless, arrogant, depressing, violent, self-aware, emotional, intellectually traumatized, highly emotional, manipulative, self-serving, spiritually doubtful, often reckless or suicidal, prone to bursts of anger, decidedly prone to substance abuse, dedicated to persuading matters of justice over matters of legality, even to self-destructive impulses, seductive and sexually appealing. Byronic heroes also tend to only seem loyal to themselves and their core beliefs and values, while they often act to behalf of greater goods. They will rarely acknowledge doing so. Byron's writings are more patently autobiographic than even those of his fellow self-revealing romantics. Upon close examination, however, the paradox of his complex character can be resolved into understandable elements. Byron early became aware of reality's imperfections, but the skepticism and cynicism bred of disillusionment coexisted with a lifelong propensity to seek ideal perfection in all of life's experiences. Consequently, he alternated between deep-seated melancholy and humorous mockery in his reaction to the disparity between real life and his unattainable ideas. The melancholy of Failed Herald and the satiric realism of Don Juan are thus two sides of the same coin. The former runs the gamut of the moods of romantic despair in reaction to life imperfections, while the latter exhibits the humorous irony attending the unmasking of the hypocritical facet of reality. Lord Byron was an English romantic poet and satirist whose poetry and personality captured the imagination of Europe. As his name would show, Byron was born into a noble English family. He lived a life as a beggar and a proud and snobbish genius focused only to his own passions. Lord Byron forms part of the second generation of romantic poets, including Percy Bysshe Shelley, Mary Shelley, and John Keats. Byron, however, was still influenced by 18th century satirists and was perhaps the last romantic of the three. His amounts with a number of prominent but married ladies was also a way to voice his descent on the hypocrisy of a high society that was only apparently religious but in fact largely liberant, and the same that he had derided him for being physically impaired. This is the end of our lecture. Conclusion. Lord Byron, British romantic poet and satirist, whose poetry and personality capture the imagination of Europe. Byron's first published volume of poetry, Hours of Idleness, appeared in 1807. Though during his lifetime, Byron consciously attempted to fashion a public identity for himself through his poetry and letters after his death. Artists, historians, philosophers, and politicians of every ideological stripe adopted him for their purposes. Byron's writings are more patently autobiographical than even those of his fellow self-revealing romantics. The archetype or character type of the Byronic hero was first developed by the famous 19th century English romantic poet Lord Byron. Here given the revision questions after the lecture. What was Lord Byron's given name? What deformity was Byron born with? What was Byron's first published book of poetry? What was the result of Byron's trip to Europe? Why was Byron forced to leave England for good? Who became his best friend? Here given the glossary concerning our lecture. Here given the literature for further reading.